Good morning, church family, and welcome. Welcome to our service together this morning. Are you excited to be here? Well, Darren's upstanding. Let's join him. Let's get into it. Let's stand and sing together. Lord, for bringing us into this place this morning, Father. Thank you, Lord, for what you're going to be doing to you today, Lord. Please open our hearts, Lord, open our minds to hear from you this morning. And Lord God, I just thank you so much for my church family. I thank you that we can come together today. Amen. Amen.
make someone feel welcome that you haven't said hello to yet? Find someone. All right. Well, looks like the teens are on as well. The teens are on as well. They're all gone. All right. Okay. Ben, you're the lolly person today. What do you reckon? If we're going to celebrate, we might as well get, you know, young Ben up. He's fitting, you know, looking. Now, I didn't see many birthdays on my list. We'll get to that in a minute. We'll see if anyone. But I know the Corkery's had an anniversary. How many years for the Corkery's? 46 years. Happy anniversary. Happy anniversary to you. Very good. And would you believe out of nearly a couple of hundred people on the church list, that's the only ones I saw. Anyone else had a birthday or an anniversary this week? You had a birthday this week. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. That's it. Happy birthday to Darren. Very good. All right, anyone else had a birthday, an anniversary, or you want to celebrate something? No? You're all happy? Everyone's good? What's that, sorry? Happy chappies, that's good. Well, you get a lollipop, Ben. How good's that? Well, it's great to be with you, church family. It's lovely to see you today. And for those watching online in the rain today, it's nice to have you with us as well. Easter's coming fast, isn't it? Who can believe it? And it's an early Easter this year, so it is coming fast. So just remember our Easter services. We will be having a communion service on the Thursday night, so 7 o'clock. So that's normally, you know, a bit more of a quieter service. If you want to come along and just think about what the death of Jesus really means and that sacrifice, come along. Good Friday will be another communion service. That's going to be the combined churches. It's our turn to host, so it's going to be at our church this year. So that'll be with New Hope and C3 and Gateway all coming here on Good Friday to celebrate the cross together. And so don't miss out on that, Good Friday. And then Sunday, of course, 9 a.m, celebrating the resurrection, amen? He is risen. And that's the hope that we've just sung about. The grave has no hold on me because Jesus is risen. So get involved in what's happening around Easter. I know some will take the time to go away, but if you're here, get involved in those services. It's a wonderful opportunity to celebrate Jesus. It's also a great opportunity to invite your family and friends and neighbours to any of the services. They're all going to be different. Good Friday, we will have a kids ministry. So if you've got neighbours with kids, say, come along. We're going to have activities for the kids during the service. Bring the kids that day as well on Sunday. So look, get involved. Here's your opportunity to go and invite someone and just have those conversations as well. SRE, keep praying for SRE. We need another teacher for Caves Beach Primary on a Thursday. Maybe that's you that you can help out. I think it's the little kids, isn't it, Samantha, we're looking for, the little kindergartens. So, you know, that's Minnie. There you go. You get to be Minnie's SRE teacher. And so get involved in SRE. It's a great opportunity. There's a bit of training you have to do, but all the materials are provided. You've got all the resources to tell the story. They've got some books they can work on. And the little kids, their questions aren't as hard as the older kids, I don't think, are they, Samantha? Nah, you get some of the easy questions. They're beautiful little kids. So be praying about that. Even if it's not you, be praying that the right person becomes available, because we always say it's sad when there's kids in school that say, come and tell me about Jesus. And we go, we can't. We've got no one to do it. And I find that a little sad as well, which I'm sure you do as well. So be praying into that as well. All right, that's the only things on my little list for getting going towards Easter. So can we pray for our church family? Can we do that, please? Heavenly Father, you are good. We've just sung about the hope we have, and the hope isn't in anything else other than you, Jesus. We thank you for the joy of coming together today. We thank you for the joy of all the resources you give us, for the building we sit in, for all the ministry things we get to do. But we do that, Lord, as an outflowing of what you have done for us. Our hope rests in what you have done. In response to your love, we want to love people well, God. So we want to pray. We want to pray for spiritual conversations. We want to pray for the confidence to invite, to offer that opportunity to people. We want to pray for people to be raised up for all the different ministry needs we have, and we think particularly of SRE, God, that you might raise the right person that's going to be able to tell these beautiful young kids about Jesus. We want to thank you for our local schools, and we want to pray, God, for every Christian particularly that's in those schools, that you would help them to be salt and light. And we think of Belmont Christian as well, and we continue to pray for Luke with his role in Belmont Christian, that he'll be a blessing to the kids there in Belmont Christian School as well. Lord, we recognise there is but one true God. And so we want to thank you for the opportunity on Good Friday to come together with other churches to together say we believe that Jesus died for our sins. So we thank you for that opportunity. We know, Jesus, you asked that the church would be one. So we want to thank you for that opportunity to honour your prayer, Jesus. And we pray it'd be a really joyful time together of celebrating who you are, Jesus. May there be salvations this Easter, God, we pray. May there be people, as we talked about the other week, you must be born again. May there be people that recognise their need for Jesus this Easter, we pray. Lord, we thank you for all the fun things in life as we've celebrated with wedding anniversaries and all those fun things. And yet again, we just continue to uphold those that are struggling with grief, with sickness, with all the many challenges of this temporary life. We ask you, God, to comfort people, to journey alongside people, remind them that you are always with your people, always loving your people, and you always have a good plan, even when we can't feel it and we can't see it. Help us to trust. Help us to do what we sung before, to raise a hallelujah in the presence of our enemies, in the presence of difficulty. Help us to still trust you, we pray, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Very good. We're going to take up our offering. We thank you for our generous givers, church. And for those giving online, we thank you for that. And for those that have come prepared, we're going to take up that during our next song. Thanks, team.
I will just quickly say, Minnie came home on Thursday and she was so excited. She's like, "Mum, I saw someone at school today and their name starts with S." I'm like, "What?" She's like, "Their name starts with S." I'm like, "Okay. What letter is that?" She's like, "S." I'm like, "Okay." And I'm like, "What's the next letter?" And she, "A." Okay. And I'm like, "So Sam." And she's like, "Yes." I'm like, "Who is Sam?" She's like, "Mum, you know Pastor Sam." She was my SRE teacher and she was so excited. And Sam, I know you don't, you know, love doing the kindy kids all the time, but Minnie was blessed that you were there. So thank you for what you give in SRE. Alright, let's stand and sing together as we take up the offering.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore. You are love.
Bible, Lord. As we get into the Word, Father, I just pray that we'd be waiting to hear from you, Father, Lord. Speak directly to us this morning. Lord, I just pray and I just thank you that we can open the Word together, Lord. And Lord, I just pray that this next part of our service would just be just another amazing time of spending time with you, God, and with our church fellowship, Father. Thank you, Father, for this. Amen. All right, I'm going to invite my friend Belinda. Oh, no. Oh, I did too. Sorry, I missed a bit. Sorry, Dan.
You're skipping ahead. That's okay. All right. Most of you, hopefully by now, will be aware that our church is part of a church planning network and in partnership with a couple other churches. So we're going to hear a little update from Chimaney from Christchurch Summerland on the video first, and then Dan's going to come and share a bit about what's happening at Table Church for us.
Hi, everyone. God is good. Thank you for your prayers. We have been able to start two new ministries in this year. We started Kid Church and youth group in the community. Thank you for your prayers. We are bringing the prayer request, please. Pray for us that God will lead us and give us a wisdom to lead them to become whom God wants them to become. And also, we are going to have the international dinner May this year. Please pray for us that this international dinner will be an outreach to the community, that people will come to know who Christ is as they're having fun. Please pray for us. Thank you very much. Thank you for being with us all the time and in prayer. May God bless you. Thank you very much. Please pray for us. Thank you.
Jermaine, all right, Dan.
Good morning. In February, our Table Church team went out to Port Stephens and we had a bit of a team retreat. It was an amazing time. It was so, I think, vital for us in terms of growing together as a team, but also just because we're at that stage where what we're doing is basically still just an experiment, right? So we're kind of discerning, where's God going to take this long term? What does ministry fruit look like? What does financial sustainability look like? And so part of what we did was set a few goals around these things. What I'd love for you guys to do is just join us in praying for some of those things. I might get Matt to put in an email for you or something so you can remember it. But just to share a couple of them with you, one of the goals we set for this year is that we want to find 9 new people to read the Bible with us. Another one is that we want to see 4 people commit themselves to Christ through baptism. Another one is that at the moment we all meet in my home on Sundays for our lunch and what we call our table service. Our hope and prayer is that at some point this year we get to that crucial point where we go, we actually can't keep doing it just here. Our vision is not to then move into a hall, but it's actually to multiply out into more houses. So one of our goals is that we might see that second house started this year, the second table. And finally, on the money piece, goal 4 that I'd love for you to be praying into is that we're needing to see $15,000 of new regular offering this year, $15,000. I wanted to share these specifically because I think it's actually quite important to be able to pray specifically. Throughout the end of last year in particular, a bunch of stuff happened at Table Church, which just made it so clear and blatantly obvious that prayer is what makes all the difference in what we're doing. So if you're up for it, I'd love it if you could like set a reminder or something in your phone, like at one point each week, whether it's Sunday night, whatever, you can work that out, I think. But I'd love for you, if you just had this one regular point to stop and pray specifically into those 4 goals, I think that's going to make all the difference. So thank you for the prayer support that we've gotten and are getting through our relationship. It's really awesome. The other thing I wanted to let you know about again is just the Easter egg hunt on Saturday, the 30th, 10 a.m., down at Chain Valley Bay. We've been thinking through how do we support the community, how do we have a presence in the community, and how can we continue to grow and lean into ministry with families. So we're going to put on a hunt for kids. There's going to be like a Christian Easter talk as part of that. But really, it's just about relationship building. We don't know if we're going to get like 10 kids that come to this or 100 kids that come to this. It's really like a trial year for us. We'll see how it goes. But we do need a couple more helpers. So if you think you can take some plastic eggs and throw them across the field, we need you. If you think you're able to roll a sausage on a barbecue, we also need a couple barbecue helpers. So if you're happy to join in, just let me know. You can do. We can find something for you, basically. Nothing too challenging. So thank you again for your support. Shall I pray? I can pray. Board games is certainly still happening. Yeah, so in terms of like what does Table Church look like right now? This year we've decided that a really big focus for us is going to be around the coaching space. So we have our table services, our church services every 2 weeks on Sunday lunch. We have every other week we're doing team discipleship and training time. Every month we put on a community board games event. And the idea is that through building relationships through our board game event, through social spaces, we're inviting people to go deeper with us by coming into a table service, by reading the Bible with us, whatever it might be. And so thinking then strategically, what's this Easter event about? Well, our hope is that through building relationships at our hunt, we might actually see some families who say, you know what, we want to come along to board games. And through coming along to board games, we might see people who say, you know what, we're happy to have dinner with you, spiritual conversation, reading the Bible, seeing people come to know God. So bit of an overview for you. Happy to chat more. Yeah. Well, let me pray. Father God, we thank you so much for being a God that wants us to join you in your mission. And we thank you for how we're able to do that here at Swansea, as well as down in Lake Monmore and Chain Valley Bay, and over in Gwendolyn and Summerlin Point as well. Father, we're in your hands. So Father, right now I ask that you fill us with wisdom, give us guidance. Lord, fill us with passion and excitement to talk to people about who you are, all that you're doing in our lives and in the lives of those around us. Lord, I want to pray specifically over some of those goals I shared for Table Church. Lord, may it be that this year Table Church sees 4 new baptisms. And may the year after see more than 4, and the year after more than that again. Lord, we thank you, and amen.
So yeah, do keep supporting and praying for our church plants and for everything that's happening there. And see Dan, it's a good opportunity while he's actually here to sign up for the Easter egg hunt rather than having to ring him or he's here today. So get your Bibles ready and thank you, Belinda.
So today the reading's split into 3 different parts. So starting at John 11, verse 1. A man named Lazarus was sick. He lived in Bethany with his sisters, Mary and Martha. This is the Mary who later poured the expensive perfume on the Lord's feet and wiped them with her hair. Her brother Lazarus was sick. So the two sisters sent a message to Jesus telling him, "Lord, your dear friend is very sick." But when Jesus heard about it, he said, "Lazarus's sickness will not end in death. No, it happened for the glory of God, so that the Son of God will receive glory from this." Then moving down to verse 11. Then he said, "Our friend Lazarus has fallen asleep, but now I will go and wake him up." The disciples said, "Lord, if he is sleeping, he will soon get better." They thought Jesus meant Lazarus was simply sleeping, but Jesus meant Lazarus had died. So he told them plainly, "Lazarus is dead. and for your sakes, I'm glad I wasn't there, for now you will really believe. Come, let's go see him. Thomas, nicknamed the twin, said to his fellow disciples, let's go too and die with Jesus. And then moving down to verse 38. Jesus was still angry as he arrived at the tomb. A cave with a stone rolled across its entrance. Roll this stone aside, Jesus told them. But Martha, the dead man's sister, protested. Lord, he has been dead for 4 days. The smell will be terrible. Jesus responded, didn't I tell you that you would see God's glory if you believe? So they rolled the stone aside. Then Jesus looked up to heaven and said, Father, thank you for hearing me. You always hear me, but I said it out loud for the sake of all these people standing here, so that they will believe you sent me. Then Jesus shouted, Lazarus, come out. And the dead man came out, his hands and feet bound in grave cloths, his face wrapped in a headcloth. Jesus told them, unwrap him and let him go. Many of the people who were with Mary believed in Jesus when they saw this happen.
Thank you, Belinda. Lazarus, come out. It's a dramatic phrase, isn't it? Actually, one commentary I read made this interesting point. If Jesus hadn't used Lazarus's name and just said, all you who are dead, come out, there would have been a big rush. And that's why it's good to actually read sometimes the fine print. What is happening here is very intentional. And it is the climax before the Easter story. It is why the Easter story happens. And if you notice in those three extracts that Belinda read, thank you, Belinda, again, you'll see a reoccurring phrase, that they may believe, that they may believe. God's glory through believing in Jesus. That's the point of it. And I wanted us to take a little tour through the run-up to John 11 and through John 11 this morning, and to then reflect on the struggles of belief in our day, perhaps, to fully believe. And what does fully believe actually look like? But I have in my heart to do something else. I'm just going to take this out again. This is unscripted, so I'll probably get in trouble. Our pastor, Matt, has had a bad back. He's been through a wedding. He's come back from India. I want to pray for him this morning. Is that okay? Father God, I want to thank you for Matt and Samantha. I want to thank you for their incredible heart to seek first your kingdom and to trust you for the rest. For them and their family, I pray deep peace, deep healing, and may your grace continue to shine through them. In Jesus' name, amen. Am I sacked? Is that all right? Oh, good. You never know. I once moved a piano and got in trouble in a church, so I have to check. Long story. Okay. Now, as Matt said, we've jumped a few chapters. So if you've got your Bibles, I'm just going to touch on a couple of extracts from the chapters running up to John 11. So we got up to John chapter 4. Which is just so wonderful. The woman at the well, I love it. But anyway, I love it. Why? God's grace. God's grace. He goes to the enemy of his people and exposes who he is, even before other people know. God's grace. You know, we get upset when someone hurts us just a little bit. He goes to the people who like to spit on Jews and throw rocks at Jews and says, I'm here. And they believe. They believe. Then in chapter 5, he does a healing at the pool. Again, miraculous thing. It's interesting. Two things happen in these chapters running up into chapter 11, and it's continued in chapter 11. Something miraculous happens. People believe, and people want to get him. That's the dual dynamic. Some people increasingly believe, others get increasingly angry. And that is part of us following Jesus, by the way. Both of those dynamics are real in our human nature. We'll explore that a bit more. So, for example, in verse 15 in chapter 5, the man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who had healed him. And this is why the Jews were persecuting Jesus. Why? He broke their rules, because he did it on the Sabbath. It wasn't, oh, well, you mustn't be God because you're healing. It's you did not play by the rules, Jesus. You broke our human conventions, Jesus. So they were angry at him. And then we go at the end of chapter 5, for if you believe Moses, you would believe me, for he wrote of me. But if you do not believe his writings, how will you believe my words? Again, it's this tension. Do you believe? What does that look like? Then we have John chapter 6, a wonderful long full chapter. Can't go through all of it. Jesus starts teaching that he is the bread. Now notice, because the preachers in when we had John chapter 3 and 4 were talking about how when Jesus speaks, he sometimes uses a physical example to demonstrate a spiritual reality. You know, he says to Nicodemus, mate, you've got to be born of water and the Spirit. You've got to be born of water and from above. You know, the physical and the spiritual kind of mirror each other. To the woman at the well, if you knew what water I was offering you, you would never thirst again. She says, you don't have a bucket. What are you talking about? He's asking her to look up, to think of the eternal. And so she does believe. And likewise in John chapter 6. But again, we see the tension. Many people started to believe in Jesus. And we speak here sometimes of the crowds, the people of peace, and discipleship. You'll see in the pattern in John, the crowds, when Jesus is appearing before the big crowds, it's like he's saying, well, here I am. Let me introduce myself. Are you interested? And some of them go, yay, and others go, no, we don't like this guy. Then there's a kind of those more closer to him, and he says to them, I'm going to teach you more deeply. Do you still want to go the journey? And then there's those who, when he says, follow me, they follow him. And we see this pattern again, because when Jesus has appeared to the crowd and said, are you interested? They say, yes, and he teaches them more and more deeply. We've got this stunning verse in John 6:66. Now, for those of you who like Bible numerology, I'm not very strong at it, but 666 is called, does anyone know what it's called? The devil's number. And it's the only place I can find it in the Bible. If you can find chapter 6, verse 66 anywhere else, can you let me know? Because I'd be interested in having a look. But listen to what 666 says in John's Gospel. After this teaching of who he really is, many of his disciples turned back and no longer walked with him. They took up the invitation to be interested. He taught them more deeply and they went, nope, we're out of here. Isn't that fascinating? There are different people. John chapter 7. Officers are sent to arrest Jesus because he keeps teaching and doing stuff. And people are saying, can this be really the Messiah? And again, the tension of who wants to believe and who doesn't continues in John chapter 7. Because the officers sent to arrest go back to their bosses, and the officers say to their bosses, no one ever spoke like this man. He is different. There is something about this guy. We can't do what you automatically wanted us to do. Their hearts are stirred. And of course, their bosses, the Pharisees, say, have you also been deceived? Have any of the authorities or the Pharisees believed in him? And Nicodemus speaks up for Jesus. John chapter 8, we had the woman caught in adultery, Jesus speaking on truth. And in John chapter 8, we get this fascinating exposure of the one who's promoting the tension, the father of lies. When he lies, he speaks his native language. Or, as the ESV has it here, when he lies, he speaks out of his own character. You see, we are asked to believe in Jesus. But let me tell you, I believe in our age, we have people who are excellent of asking us to believe in almost Jesus, kind of Jesus, the thumbprint of Jesus, but not Jesus himself. Then we get to John chapter 9. We could do the whole Bible if I kept up at this rate. No, I'm just saying. Okay, John chapter 9. I love John chapter 9. Haven't got time to go through it in the detail. But this is the guy who was also healed, another healing, or six healings coming up to Lazarus, number seven. And Jesus at first doesn't tell this guy who he is. He just knows that I was blind and now I'm not. And he celebrates. Would you think that'd be a reason for celebrating? I think so. You know, blind and now not blind. Interestingly, the start of this story is like the start of chapter 11. The disciples say, well, is he a sinner or are his parents a sinner, Jesus? How come he's blind? Simple answer. So that you can believe by what I now do. So that you can believe by what I now do. So he heals. And I love the unfolding of this. And again, it exposes how belief is not straightforward. People can have evidence, black and white, in front of them, but they do not believe. Why? Isn't that what, you know, Matt encourages us properly, week in and week out, to invite people to meet Jesus? And in Australia, it's hard. It is hard. I was once with a group of students in Africa. We were at a pastor's prayer breakfast. We were ministering there, just doing simple stuff with this group of year 11, 10, 11 and 12 students. And at the end of it, we went to pray for this group of pastors working in, Kenya. And a Chinese man got up and said, "No, Stephen, we need to pray for you and your team." And as he spoke, I realized he was Aussie. He looked Chinese. He was Australian, an ABC, we call them in Sydney. Australian-born Chinese, okay? And he was Australian-born Chinese working in Kenya, for God. So he understood kind of cross-cultural stuff really well. He was a beautiful fella. I said, "Why do you have this urge to pray for us?" He says, "You're returning to the most spiritually dry continent on the planet." Now, you may or may not agree with him, because even some places that persecute Christians are still very spiritually out there. They have an explicit spiritual belief in something other than Jesus. But his insight was, in Australia, people want to close off their spirit, and in closing off their spirit, they don't have to worry about God. We don't have to talk about God if we deny that we aren't spiritual. So it is hard. And so right here in John chapter 9, the guy gets brought before the religious leaders. "Who healed you?" "I don't know. I just know that I was blind and now I see." So they bring in the parents. And the parents say, "He's a grown up." Talk about dodgeball. My goodness. You would think you would be so thankful that your son can now see. You would just want to thank God for it. But they are so scared of the existing way of living, they almost disown their son. Isn't that terrible? And so we'll talk to him. So they talk to him again. And he says, "This guy called Jesus, he just healed me." Anyway, Jesus meets him after this and introduces who he deeply is. And again, that question, "Do you believe?" And the guy says, "Yes, Lord, I believe." Jesus then goes on teaching about being the true shepherd, in contrast, interestingly, to Ezekiel 34 in the Old Testament. Then we get to the passage we read this morning, the death of Lazarus. Now, even from the extracts we read, notice Lazarus is really sick and obviously about to die. And Jesus, even though he had deep relationship with Lazarus and his sisters Mary and Martha, stalls going. He doesn't go. And we can see that emphasized, because when he does get there, both the sisters say to him,
Lord, if you had been here, our brother would not have died. Why? Because they've seen him heal and have believed in him to that point. Jesus, we know you can stop sickness. You can heal blindness. We know you can. If you were here, Lazarus, your dear friend, would still be alive. That's why the disciples were confused before he went, because Jesus again used metaphor language. Well, he's just sleeping. And they thought, oh, he's sleeping. Good, he'll wake up. No, boys, let me unpack it again. He's going to die. But he's going to die so that you can see God's glory through what he's called me to do. And in that, understand more deeply who I am. In John, that's very purposeful. There's seven times Jesus says, I am. And in these seven miracles in John, he's demonstrated who he is as he says, I am. Now you can see this is running up to the Easter event, because at this stage, he's about to call out Lazarus from the dead, and that's a window into, but can Jesus come back from the dead? It's one thing to call someone else out, but what about for yourself? It was, I hope I'm not stealing Matt's thunder, it was what they yelled at him when he was on the cross. You rescued others, rescue yourself. Ha, who are you really, Jesus? But again, notice the sisters' journey in this. You know, they say, we believe you are the Messiah. And then he takes them a little journey. No, I'm going to demonstrate to you that I am even master over death. Oops, next page. And so Martha says, yes, Lord, I believe that you are the Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God, who is coming or who has come into the world, in verse 27. Now, Jesus knows what God is asking him to do. He knows the reasons his Father is asking him to do it. Does that mean he is detached from this? No. Now, Matt tells us that the shortest English verse is not the shortest verse in Greek. Is that right, Matt? I listen. On a good day? No. So we have in this passage where Jesus weeps. Some debates about why he wept. But he was involved. He was attached to this moment. His best friends, Lazarus, the sisters, Mary and Martha, and he used to stay with them when he was in their town. And this whole moment, the pathos of the moment, he expresses. He's fully God and fully human being. And he weeps. And then he does the targeted calling out. Now, I don't know how the Chosen are going to do this, because Sandy and I do watch that. But my mind goes nuts. Imagine you're Lazarus. You know, we've got books written about people who died and believe that they kind of spiritually started to go from here to the non-embodied souled world. And it's, you know, does my head in a bit, but there's realities of who we are. We're spiritual, we're physical, we've got this interesting mix. That's why we're unique. Can you imagine Lazarus? He's died. Did the Father say to him, mate, don't get too comfortable? This is going to be just a little one this time around. How do you make sense of that? Although, interestingly, I once had a student who helped make sense of that. She was 11 the first time she died. She had cancer. And her testimony was that when she was passing on, that's why I use the phrase passing on rather than dying, this beautiful young lady, when she was passing on, she asked God to come back because she had more work to do with members of her family. And she did. Another 18 months, was it, down, something like that? Sandy and I had the privilege of going with her on her next journey of passing on, and she passed in beautiful, deep peace. She was an angel. When I'd visit her in John Hunter, I'd say to the nurses, where's the little angel today? They knew exactly who I was talking about. She had this incredible sense of humor right to the end. And she knew God. She knew God. And she believed deeply. And she blessed us mightily. So, I mean, for Lazarus, we don't know. is one of the long list of questions when I get to heaven. Can I talk to Lazarus? I know Abraham's important. I know Moses is, but I want to sit with Lazarus just for a little bit, please. And say, mate, what was it like? And imagine he's coming out and he's got all the stuff on and it's falling off him. Can you imagine? How do you process that? You're one of the mourners who are visiting Mary and Martha, doing your good thing, helping the sisters. They're going to the grave and they think, okay, must be another ceremony down at the grave. You go to the grave and the guy walks out in front of you. How do you make sense of that? I don't know. The reason it happens is, again, it's an invitation to believe in Jesus, who he is. If he is, if we go right back to John 1, the Word through whom all things are made, for whom all things are made, in whom all things hold together, then this should not surprise us. But in our world, where we are spiritual as well as physical, the physical dominates and we have trouble coming to grips with these spiritual realities. How can someone's word overcome physical reality? We've just seen it in the story of Lazarus. That's why Jesus is trying to say to them, believe and believe deeply. Notice what Jesus prays in verse 42. I knew that you always hear me, Father, but I said this on account of the people standing around, that they may believe you sent me. Notice Jesus is doing this amazing thing, and his direction every time is up. That you have sent me, that this will glorify you. And then in the next section, verse 45, many of the Jews, therefore, who had come with Mary and had seen what he did, believed in him. Hey, it's cool. It's just like the woman at the well. It's true. Seen it with my own eyes. And they go, it makes sense. We believe in this guy called Jesus Christus. We're going to pin our badge with him. What happens? The rulers don't like it, so they plot further to take him out. The build-up to Easter. And just before I reflect a little bit more on today, I want to jump over to John 12. Is anyone doing John 12? Okay. Palms under. All right. Well, I'm going to pinch verse 10. Is that all right? Notice how I always check. Verse 10. So the chief priests made plans to put Lazarus to death as well. Why? I mean, the guy's just risen from the dead and they want to put him back there. Talk about distorted human thinking. He's already been tried to be held by death once. It did not work. But they decide we're going to try again. Why? Because on account of him, many of the Jews were going away and believing in Jesus. See the pattern? We are called to be interested in Jesus, to listen deeply to Jesus, and to believe in Jesus. Fully believe. Be absolutely convinced that he is who he says he is. And for that to make a difference in what we do. It's why I love church. It's why I love fellowship. It's why I love all the precious, beautiful little things that we as community do together. It's why I love seeing my dear wife go with the creative ladies. You know, without Jesus, that kind of stuff doesn't happen. You might say, oh, yeah, but surely people who don't believe in Jesus do some of that stuff. That's true. I'm a social anthropologist by background and psychologist. Let me tell you, in studies of history in the world, only when there's the Jews and Christians around do we have the kind of softer society we have in Australia. Because without that, people want control. They want to shape it into their ideas. You know, I grew up at a time where I think we were mistaken. We said, well, look, more and more people don't believe in God. We'll just keep doing our thing. It won't really make much of a difference. Wrong. It does make a difference. Why? Just read the Gospels. Because people either get angry and upset. They can't control people who believe in God. Or they believe, and even if they're persecuted, They do good stuff anyway. And that has confused people lots. I do strange things, like I go on and read the Humanist Association stuff in Britain sometimes. And one of their leaders put out this plea one day. He said, look, and it's very much like a Roman emperor did in the 300s, I think. Hey, look, we've got to do better. These Christians, even when we make life hard, still do good stuff. You know, they run orphanages, they're hospitals, they care for each other, they run youth groups. I mean, what would Australia do without youth groups? Much poorer for it. Let me tell you, I do work in this last week, I've worked with people online in Poland. Last night at 9 o'clock, a beautiful woman in Lithuania, let me tell you, her testimony is amazing. Was supposed to die. But instead, she started a Christian school and had two children that she was never supposed to have. And online, I had a chat with Emmanuel and Johanna. God's grace in action when people actually believe. It makes a difference. There were some researchers who coined a term for what I'm calling the almost belief, which is happening in our world. It's called moral therapeutic deism, MTD. I call it therapeutic Christianity. What they interviewed 2,000 American teens, religious teens, and they wanted to get their understanding of their belief in God. And what they found was, and they summarized it, my paraphrase, is they believe in God and Jesus because Jesus helps us understand what's good to do. That's the moral part. But when they're in trouble, God's great to pray to because it helps us feel better. That's the therapeutic, okay? And if we really need confidence that someone's in control, we can say, oh, well, God's there. That's what I call the butler part. God is both a therapist and he's a butler. Dear God, I need this now. Can you please make this happen? Dear God, I feel really bad. Please make... Now, there is kernels of truth in those prayers. That's why you have laments in the Bible. But it is not giving God the glory for who he is and trusting that he is doing good even when it hurts. It's only if it makes me feel better. That is the almost Jesus that some people have been describing. I call it therapeutic Christianity. It's why I love in this church we hear the gospel. We're all broken. Yeah. We all need healing. Sandy and I were talking about that quote that came up about grace. We're all broken. We all need mending. Grace is the glue. Excellent quote. That's what it's about. Surrendering to God. I've shared with some people, over Christmas break, I took away Eric Clapton's autobiography. Yes, I do like rhythm and blues. Does that take me down or up? I have no idea. Up, thank you, dear sister. Bless you. Down, Darren. Come on, man. Let me guess. Country rock? I don't know. All right. Sometimes, yes, you'll hear me plug my guitar in and play along with guys like that. Anyway, read his autobiography. His first, I don't know, decades of life were chaos, held together by music in the face of his absolutely rotten relationships and drug abuse of various kinds. You get to page 270 in the book. It's a long book, but easy read. And he says, my knees gave way. I fell to the floor and surrendered to God. And then the rest of the book describes the difference that made, which is just fantastic. You see, we get to let go and accept who Jesus really is, or we invent lots of reasons to either soften almost Jesus or just get angry and reject. Now, what do we do about it? Well, I want to go back to another passage, different gospel, in Matthew's gospel. Do you all know the story of the wise person is the person who built their house on the... Okay, you know. The wise man built his house upon the rock. Those older ones, on the rock. The foolish man built his house upon the... Okay, the later, what was the later version of it? Don't build your house on the sandy land. For the slightly younger ones, But even then, you'd have to be about 40. that was what we taught our children. So that really, really, I want you to turn to a neighbour now. Time's almost gone, so you've only got about 30 seconds for this. What made, when Jesus was telling that story, what was the point, the action that, and you're not allowed to use your Bibles. I saw that. Teacher at heart. Scan the kids. Make sure they're doing what you want. Now, turn to your neighbour and say, what made people wise? Jesus said, if you do this, you will be like the wise man. What was the this in that well-known story? It's okay if you don't know. So I'm asking the question. So when I... Okay, turn to your neighbour, 30 seconds, figure it out. You have 10 more seconds. Okay. When I ask this question of Christian kids in youth groups, Christian schools, whatever, mostly I get, love Jesus. And I say, yes, we should. Amen. That's not what Jesus said. And these lovely generic terms come up, which are actually right in spirit, but there's something very specific Jesus said. When you hear these words of mine and put them into practice. And it's a theme in Matthew's gospel. Once when Jesus' mum and brothers came to visit him and someone said, hey, Jesus, your family's outside. He said, my family are those who hear my words and put them into practice. And you can see that again and again. What is the work that we have to put into practice? Well, if I go back to John 6, which is the point of John 11, Jesus said this when he was asked, Master, what is the work that we should do? This was his response. Believe in him who was sent. That's our work. There's lots of invitations for almost Jesus. I think increasingly in our world, there's people who are more brazenly wanting to be anti-Jesus. We are to love all those people. And how are we to love them? As Jesus would love them. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for Jesus. How can we not thank him for you, Father? We are followers of the way of Jesus Christ. Father, help us to understand that more deeply. Help us to more fully believe. Help us to see the opportunities you give us today and every day this week to testify to Jesus, the one who died, rose, ascended, sent his spirit, the one who rose Lazarus purely by the words he spoke. Father, may our lives be salt and light wherever we are. At home, Father, may people see our homes as different. In the workplace, Father, may we be salt and light and people wonder how come we live a little bit differently. At school, college, university, Father, may people see our heart for truth, our heart for mercy more and more clearly. Father, help us to surrender to you each morning, each evening, to let go, to seek first your kingdom, your grace, your mercy, your truth, and to trust you for the rest. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thanks, David. Please stand as we sing together.
gracious to you, Lord, turning face toward you.
Great to see this place packed and people asking questions about Jesus. Amen. All right, have a great one.